David, you want to do the introduction? I mean, you want to the show open?
I was hoping to be ready for that. I'm still a little jet lagged.
You just got back.
Tell me what episode number. I might be able to try that.
I guess I'd have to tell you that. I have to go to YouTube every time to find out what the episode number is because I never remember. It is episode 330, Emcomm Extra, number 13. And the title will be, I think, Auxcom Explained. And I may have just done the introduction, but you want to do that? You want to audition for?
I could try.
Let me promote you to full screen.
Ham Radio Now, episode 330, and Emcomm Extra, episode number 13, Auxcom Explained. With our guest, Steve Schroeder, is K10KY. No, KI0KY.
How long have you been a ham?
6 years.
K10KY.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
I'm going to leave that in, by the way. You're stuck with it.
Excellent.
Okay. I'm stuck with it. You get to say who you are.
Oh, yes. And I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
And I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. We are the hosts.
We are. And our guest, Steve.
So not bad for your first time introducing the show.
Yeah, I'm going to start practicing in the bathroom in front of the mirror.
Yep. So before we get to talking to Steve, we do the fundraising thing. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. There's an Arvin on the shelf behind me, and there's an Arvin on the shelf behind David. HamRadioNow.tv is the website. Wrong button. HamRadioNow.tv is the website to go through and help us cover the expenses and stuff. So I just realized I made a color adjustment to this camera, and I only applied it to this view and not to any of the others. So I'm going to switch back and forth from being a little greener to a little pinker.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe let me fix that. So, as we begin this episode, an Emcomm Extra episode, somewhat appropriately, there is a potential Emcomm thing going on. This is Tropical Storm Cindy. My wife likes the concept, although they spell it wrong. And it is bearing down on the coast of Texas and Louisiana. And there's a live radar of what's going on. Apparently, it is a non-event, at least in terms of amateur radio. So I took a look at the Hurricane Watch Net. Hurricane Watch Net is not active. Looked at the ARL website. Let me refresh just in case. So, they've got a couple of news stories, but they're not talking about anything about the hurricane.
No storm watch, just field day.
Yeah. So, but that does lead me to a question that I'll toss in a little bit later on. Real Emcomm activities that cross a field day weekend. Potentially interesting concept. But this program is Auxcom Explained. And David, you and I have talked about Auxcom several times on Ham Radio Now and the Emcomm Extra, and have expressed a little bit of bafflement, a little bit of puzzlement about what Auxcom really is. And I mean, I just did a Google search for the term Auxcom. And there's a lot of stuff, but there isn't any one thing that just exactly says what Auxcom is, except for this guy. This was an old post from 2015 on a blog site called amateurradio.com, which I am one of the participants in. I've been invited to put things there. I don't do it very often. So this is a guy who says, for those of you who are wondering what Auxcom is, that is the official name given by Homeland Security to amateur radio operators, REACT members, and others who augment the paid and training first responders during declared emergencies. Okay, so he thinks he knows what it is. And let's see, who are these guys? Oh, this is Homeland Security website. And this is just a bulletin. It's not a what Auxcom is. It's talking about a Colorado law that has created an Auxcom unit within the state's Division of Homeland Security. This is something else entirely. This is the U.S. Auxcom Society. And notice that sometimes there's one M and sometimes there's two. And this is not exactly up to date. For example, they're talking about Tropical Storm Andrea here on June 6th, 2013. So that's 4 years old, and that's on their main webpage. And they've got these state databases. They've got one for North Carolina, one for South Carolina, and one for Colorado, which is where Stephen is from. I'm still confused. As we expressed our confusion about what Auxcom really was, you sent us, David and me, an email with a good cogent explanation. And I thought, well, rather than just telling people what you said in the email, let's get you on the show and you can tell everybody. So what is Auxcom?
Okay, thanks for having me on the show. I appreciate it. I've watched a few episodes, really enjoyed them. And as I explained, first of all, Auxcom is a course put on by the Department of Homeland Security. And as sort of referenced in some of your slides there, it's designed to provide instruction for auxiliary communication volunteers to be integrated into the needs of the organizational EOCs and command posts and things like that. So it's a way for them to support ongoing public safety communications.
That seems too simple. Seems too simple.
Okay. So, and the emphasis is on how the auxiliary communicator fits into the incident command system, and then national system communications. In other words, what role they play, what responsibilities they have.
All right. So, we've got the training courses, we've got the position within incident command, and in three states anyway, we've got the Auxcom Society with a database and an old website. Are they different things? Are they the same thing? Are they going the same direction?
Each state implements Auxcom in its own way. In Colorado, we've done it different than other states. I'm not sure exactly what other states have done. But in Colorado, the law was passed where it made it a unit of the state Office of Emergency Management.
Okay, so it's an official thing in Colorado.
Yes.
At least. And I guess we should explain what your position is. You're not the section manager or an EC. You're just a member. Tell me what your actual role is.
I'm an AEC for... I'm a AEC for our district in Colorado, Western Colorado, one of the districts, and I'm an Auxcom instructor for the state of Colorado. So we have three instructors, so the state can sponsor its classes that are their DHS classes, but the state provides the instructors.
So you're an AEC, that's an ARES position?
Yes.
Is that correct? Okay.
Right.
And
the AEC stands for Assistant Emergency Communicator?
Or right.
Coordinator.
Coordinator.
Right.
Okay. Go ahead, David.
No, that's okay. And then you said you're an Auxcom instructor trainer. How did you get into the role, the instructor role? Did you have to go participate in like a FEMA organization or DHS class to learn that?
Yeah, DHS has several requirements. One of the formal positions is communications unit leader in the ICS world. And there are two brands, either the NWCG, National Wildfire Coordinating Group, or All Hazards. And so... in Colorado, I'm an all-hazards communications unit leader, and that involved taking classes and getting experience and being reviewed and certified as an all-hazards communications unit leader. That's one of the requirements to become an Auxcom instructor. You need to be at least a general class amateur radio operator with several years experience and take some additional classwork and to become an Auxcom instructor.
Okay, so I haven't heard of that all-hazards certification. I'm an EC in our area's organization here in Southern California, and it sounds like there's like different certifications or standards. How did you get that all hazards? I don't want to say certification. Is a certification or?
Yeah, it is. It's the states all have a system. Mm-hmm. It varies from state to state, but they're from DHS, their standards, and then states adopt how they do it. And essentially for all hazards, which is not ARIES, it's just part of the incident command system. There are all kinds of roles. You have, incident commander, you have logistics sections chiefs, you have division supervisors. And so under the incident commander, there's a logistics section chief, and under the logistics section chief, there's a communications unit leader. Mm-hmm. And that person manages the communications unit when you have an incident command post and things right. like that.
Yeah, and that's all under the NIMS. All under the NIMS.
Yes.
Yep. Okay.
And so you take what in Colorado, what you need to do is be associated with an organization that's tied in with the state. So I'm with the fire department, and the fire department provides people sort of under a contract to the state. Mm-hmm. And then so you have an agency that sponsors you, and then you sign up and take classes, and then you go out and get experience where you're dispatched to various incidents or training situations to get complete a task book where you have a specific task that need to get signed off, and then there's a final evaluation.
Got it. And that's all through the Colorado Office of Emergency Services.
Right.
Okay, got it.
It's a nationwide program, but each state mm-hmm. does its own certification.
They implement it different. I know there is a program here in California where they certify some of the ham radio operators, most I think in LA County. It's through the fire department, and they sign up with OES here in California as well. How long have you been doing that?
I've been a comm unit leader for 5 years.
5 years. And how long have you been a ham?
Since 1994.
Okay.
It's got you beat, David.
Yeah, almost everybody has me beat. Except Marty, but Marty's only, 12 or 14 years old.
Yeah, but on the other hand, Marty's got all of us beat.
Yeah, that's true.
So I'm wondering, with all of that training and all of that involvement, how much beyond ham radio do you go in terms of the actual activity? When you're, first of all, have you had any actual activity in the past few years? I guess most of what I hear from Colorado is fires.
Yes, I was involved in the NWCG part, the wildfire part, and I went to several fires as a radio operator. And then after I became a COM-L, I've gone to two. I'm on a incident management team here in Colorado. We have 5 Type 3 incident management teams. And I'm on the Southwest team, and we went to flooding in 2013. We went to a town called Evans, and I did a lot of logistics stuff, and I was the COM-L there. It was minimal COM-L activity. All the regular communications were intact. And we had a second incident in Durango called the Gold King Mine, where an abandoned mine failed and sent pollution down the river. And again, there was minimal communication stuff there. I worked mostly in logistics, but those are the two actual incidents that I've gone on.
That minimal amateur radio, anyway, activity seems to be a sort of recurring theme. And there's something we'll talk about a little bit later. This first, what was the name of it? Oh, I've lost my list. Oh, the first responder broadband network that starting to hear a little bit about. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But so if there wasn't much ham radio going on, what did you do, and did you participate in communications with non-amateur communication systems?
Right. Now, what I meant to say is that there was little of any kind of communications outside the normal public safety communications in both incidents. The Gold King Mine people used their cell phones, and that was a really different kind of situation. At Evans, the police department, fire department, all they had all their basic communications, and our team helped manage the operations dealing with the flooding for the city.
All right. So did you do anything other than just kind of sit around and wait for things to get worse?
No, we were there to help them deal with, to help organize the end of the response and the beginning of the recovery, if you will. Now, again, I have a limited view, but in the flooding in Colorado, they had other parts where amateur radio played a key part, where for a while, one city only had contact to the state EOC by amateur radio because the regular systems failed. But I wasn't part of that. But that's, so there is a wide range there, if you will, of activity.
Okay. Well, those are the things that we both hate to hear and love to hear.
Yeah, it happens. You know, so one of the things I'll admit, and I know Gary and I've kicked this around a little bit about not understanding completely what Auxcom is or what it means. And I think my understanding, you know, a year or two ago before I started reading too much about it was really a way to get everybody under the NIM system or under the incident command system. And it was, you know, I may be an Aries EC and you may be an Aries AEC or a DC or whatever, but when you come and report into that system, you know, you leave your hat and your badge and your name tag behind and you're part of the incident response structure, right? And whether you're an amateur radio communicator or a professional, you know, radio communicator, you know, whether you're a dispatcher or whatever, didn't really matter. You're there to provide a service and they put you where they need you. Is that kind of accurate based on your understanding of the role or what you do?
Yeah, that's very accurate. In accordance with the guidelines of the course and what they present, mm-hmm. You show up, your home agency or your base organization, you sort of leave behind, you bring your expertise and your experience, and then you be assigned as best fits the organization, the incident command.
And so in your organization, do you train on non-amateur radios? I mean, do you work with the fire department, for instance. Do you train on their call commercial or their, you know, professional radios so that you understand how they work and what you need to know to be able to support them?
Okay. So the national course doesn't mm-hmm. deal with technical issues very mm-hmm. much. Mm-hmm. It's involved with what your roles and responsibilities are and how to prepare a communications plan for using amateur radio assets and organizing the Auxcom volunteers, in like a flow chart or a organization mm-hmm. chart. Mm-hmm. In Colorado, part of the Auxcom training is one of the requirements is to take three online courses that we have in Colorado, and the state Auxcom unit has radios that are on the statewide 800 DTRS system, and there's some Auxcom talk groups in it. Mm-hmm. So in Colorado, they're trained to work on those work with those radios.
So the overall is a national kind of a guideline, and then on a state level, they'll get you up to speed on the equipment that they think that you might need to know on a more local level.
Exactly. For example, you might, on one of the exercises in the Auxcom course, you might say, we're going to provide digital communications between the EOC and the command post, but you don't go into which mode right. or which program you're going to use. It's just that you have the frequency and the designation and the operators to provide that service.
Okay. And you, so you do that. How often do you teach that course?
We just started this last year. We started in December of last year, and we've had 3 courses so far in Colorado.
So in like the last 6 months, you're doing every other month or so?
About every 3 or 4 months, yes.
Uh-huh. And are you doing it, are you like traveling across the state and or are you just doing it in your part of the, you said Western Colorado?
Right. The other 2 instructors are on the Front Range or the eastern part of the state in the Denver area. And I travel across when they have a class there, and they travel over here when we've had classes on the western side.
Do you team teach it?
Yes.
Okay. And strictly for volunteers or for other individuals as well?
It's so. Mainly for amateur radio operators. That's mm-hmm. what we've had so far in Colorado.
Uh-huh. And how many people do you think you've trained in the last 6 months or so?
We've had about approximately 50 people so far. We've had a limit of 20 in the class. The first 2 classes were full, and I think we had 16 in the third class.
Great. That's great. And after you guys do the courses, is there follow-up? Are you guys, you know, getting together on a regular basis, or are you putting a mailing list together? There's kind of communications to keep this ongoing?
Well, we're relatively new. That's planned for, and they're working on it. People that are in the state Auxcom get a certificate, a badge, if you will, part of the mm-hmm. state system. And we haven't gotten so far as to do in-service training, if you will.
Got it.
We're working on it.
Got it. I know some states do that, the badging or the identification system, and that kind of gives you credentials to get like in an EOC. It says you're trained and we know who you are and you're a known quantity and you should be capable to help support us. And you're just not some amateur radio operator that shows up off the street. That's kind of the direction of this, right?
Exactly. The state has a system and we have that system and it's used throughout the state by various agencies.
Okay. So tell me a little bit.
I'm wondering what proportion of your ARIES members of the hams that are participating in Emcomm there have been through all of this and what the requirements are for a ham to participate these days. Do they have to go through these courses and then and participate or are they just kind of working their way in?
Okay, so there are a lot of hams and ARIES members on the Front Range, and I don't know the number, but we've had in recent years 2 classes over there, so that'd be 40 people on the Western Slope. There are very few hams and very few ARIES people, and like I said, we had 16 people. Some of those came from other areas as well. So it's a relatively few number. And the requirements are, you need an amateur radio license for the federal class, and you have to have a few years' experience, I think. And you have to be associated with an agency. So if you're not associated with an emergency management organization or a police department, fire department, search and rescue, you need to do that. They want to make sure that when you've got the training that you're actively supporting an agency.
So I guess I'm not real sure when you say you have to be associated with an agency, is that as a ham, as a volunteer through ARIES or whatever, or a more formal employment?
Right. No, just essentially, if your ARIES group is supporting a sheriff's office formally or informally, that they'll say, yeah, that person supports us. That's all you need. It doesn't have to be very formal, but there has to be a relationship there.
Okay.
And so for our ARIES group here in Southern California, we'd like you to take 4 of the FEMA courses, 100, 200, 700, 800. Is that a requirement for how do you structure your ARIES organization? How do they structure it there? Is it a must-have? Is it a want-to-have? Are there other courses that you ask them to take?
I'm not sure what the other ARIES in the state do, but for the mm-hmm. Auxcom course, those are also requirements, mm-hmm. 1, 2, 7, and 800. Mm-hmm. Those are the online courses. The 300 and 400 are desired but not required. Those are classroom courses.
Got it.
And tell me about the course. How long does it run? What are you really covering? What kind of information is in there?
Okay, so the course is 20 hours, and they're always on a Friday evening and then Saturday and Sunday, designed for people who are working during the week. And there's, I think, 9 units. I'll have to count. It's actually more than that. But it discusses what your role is. It discusses positions in the instant command post, communications positions, and how you would fill them. It talks about how you behave, I would say, professionally, et cetera, in an organization. And then a main part of it is that, and you learn how to fill out a communications plan, ICS 205. You do an organization chart, so you organize your volunteers to support the incident plan. And a big part of the course are 9 exercises. And they start out with a parade that's 1.5 miles long, and they get into a wildfire and flooding and different train wreck with hazardous materials. And each scenario adds or continues to have requirements for the auxiliary communicators to support the incident. So it can be various roles, from monitoring a radio and letting somebody know if something serious happening, to sending critical information, like I mentioned before, passing data from the EOC to the command post. That system isn't normally operating every day. The EOC isn't up every day. So the auxiliary communicators get to augment the regular systems with additional circuits and channels. For instance, you might have a series of shelters and they need communications. So the auxiliary communicators provide that assistance. You may have teams that go around looking to see what the damage is. That's an excellent role for auxiliary communicators to report back to the EOC. And that's a circuit, if you will, or a capability that isn't there every day. Mm-hmm. And those things are listed. And you go from, like I said, a parade up to a statewide flooding winter storm scenario where you have to provide statewide and even interstate communications planning and capabilities.
And they talk about the planning, but they don't talk about so much of the delivery methods per se, right? That's really up to the individual group on the ground. Like, they don't say you're going to do this on UHF packet, or you're going to send NBeams messages, or it's all going to be voice or CW. That's really for the individual organization when you get down to it. Is that accurate?
Right. Well, yeah, the plan would have all that in it. So if for example, the emergency manager says, I need a voice channel from here to the shelter.
Got it.
Then it's a voice channel. If they want a data link to the EOC or to the state EOC, then you would provide that. Mm-hmm. You bring to the class a list. It's called an ICS 217, a capabilities resource list of communications assets. So you would come to the class with all what you know about repeaters and channels and HF frequencies that you use. And then that's your catalog. And then when you write the communications plan, you would choose which frequencies and channels you would use to make that plan work.
Based on the catalog of capabilities.
Yes. So, and makes that's sense. part of the goal is to have you think about, well, what are all the things we could use? So if something doesn't work, we can use this, or if we go over here, we can do that.
So that leads me to wonder something that we always talk about on these shows. What varieties of communications channels with an amateur radio do you guys in Colorado have? The backbone is always FM voice on repeaters, because everybody's got that.
Well, yeah, it varies. We have the Continental Divide dividing our state. So we have
no RF goes across that. I've been there. It's too high.
I mean, yeah, right, exactly. So Yeah, they have the Colorado connection and some other link systems that are very capable, but they don't cover everywhere. The area I'm in is sort of not connected to that. The six counties that are in the all hazards region that I'm in don't have access to the Colorado connection.
Yeah, I guess we should mention the Colorado connection is a linked repeater system. And as you say, it doesn't cover the whole state, but it covers a big part of it.
Right.
And it's linked on RF. It's not linked on the internet.
There are a couple of nodes that are internet linked, but most of it is RF to RF. Yes.
Okay.
And then there are other amateur radio clubs or organizations that are building actually their own backbone, microwave backbone. So you can talk from Wyoming down to New Mexico on voice. And a lot of people are using the, the digital data systems, Moto Turbo and the other ones.
Oh, DMR.
DMR, et cetera. Yeah. And so that. And then you have a lot of rural counties in Colorado. Some have no hams in them at all. And one of the capabilities that we are stressing is how do you communicate from the county to the state EOC? And that's where HF comes in. One of the focuses we have is that there are two reports that people are used a lot in these big emergencies. One is what's going on or the situation status report. And then what help do you need or resource management where a county would request from the state when they can't get it, what they need locally or from adjoining counties to send resources, people, material, airplanes, helicopters, whatever. So how would you send a resource request over HF radios to the state EOC when the other channels aren't working?
And how prevalent are the non-FM digital modes, DMR, D-Star? Are those in use much, or do you find that no one can agree on what to set up? And then we'll talk about the digital data modes, but I'm wondering about voice first.
I'm the sort of the blind man touching the elephant. I'm on the western side where we don't have those capabilities. They have a lot of it on the eastern side, and I'm sure others can add. They use them a lot. But part of our planning and exercise training is not to use the internet.
Right. Yeah. Nobody wants the internet as it's a tool for logistics and stuff, but not when you're really operating because it's not reliable.
Yeah. One concept I think is probably valid is that one area may not have the internet and the other area will. So you can use things like the wind link system from the remote area and send the traffic into the internet over the wind link.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So D-Star, DMR, System Fusion, their linking system is internet based in most areas. And again, you're the western part, which is rural. It's the pretty part. But it is, I guess they just don't have the digital systems up and operating out there.
They do in the larger city on the western slope is Grand Junction, and they have some of that there. But I'm one mountain ridge over, so we don't have it here.
Yeah. David, as you know, the mountain territory, everybody wants a mountain to put their repeater on, and the problem is that about 15, 20 miles away, there's another mountain that's going to block the signal.
Yeah. So that's how it goes.
Yep.
So you talked about some of the digital modes. So you talked about digital data. So WinLink, is that the go-to that you guys are using to send the forms back and forth? Are you delivering them via WinLink over HF?
That's what we've used for the last two SET exercises, statewide exercises, to practice sending information to the state EOC.
Mm-hmm. And has that worked out for you guys? You like that?
Yeah, there's a learning curve, and you have to get people up the learning curve to get ready for that.
And equipment too.
Does that give you a very limited number of operators that are trained and capable of doing that, or is that something that's becoming popular and people are learning how to do?
It is limited, and we're making progress in getting more people to do it. It's like I said, there in some areas, there are not very many hams. So they, you know, if one out of three likes digital stuff and you only have two, that's a challenge.
Yeah.
You're being kind to your operators. I will relate a brief story from when I was, back in the probably late 90s when packet was a really big deal. And North Carolina Aries was trying to get some packet implemented. And we had one drill at the State EOC where they decided to use packet. They brought in a guy who did not participate in Aries. They brought him in because he knew packet, and he knew DX packet clusters, which were a big thing at the time. But he wasn't an Aries guy, and none of the Aries guys knew about packet. And that was our, you know, our big problem is the folks that were familiar with these modes of communication, the anything besides the least common denominator, FM voice. If they knew them, they didn't do Aries. If they were in Aries, they didn't know them. Now that's a long time ago. But has it gotten much better? Feel free to say no.
No, I think it's working out. People, one, there's so many more digital modes. Most amateurs are aware of them and have done one or the other. They may not do many of them. But I think the need to send text messages that are a page long is a critical asset that we need to have.
Yeah, that's what your incident commander wants to do, right? They want to send a lot of data. They want their email, they want their internet, and they want to be able to send a message, right? Not just a couple words here and there.
Exactly. If you're going to order, make a resource request, and there's numbers and names and phone numbers and addresses, things like that, over voice, it's very slow. Mm-hmm. And impractical. And like you say, everybody's used to using their cell phone and getting a text message and sending attachments, and anything else slower than that is a challenge for some people.
So once again, are your Aries members, your Auxcom members, capable of doing that when they pick up the phone and got no bars? There's no signal here, but they've got a 100-word message to send from one place to another that is full of detailed information. Are they getting on their FM repeater going, Alpha, Bravo, figures 109er? Or do they have the capability? Does everybody have the capability to type that into something and push a button and off it goes? And if they do, which one did they pick?
Okay, so in our area, the six counties that I work in, we have two or three stations that have signal links and HF radios, and two of them have the Pactor modems. And we've practiced with others in individual stations with signal links sending FL digi traffic or WinLink WinMore traffic. We do have some packet that we've expanded in our area, so we can send packet as well. But we have practiced and demonstrated that a couple of times in the last couple of years to do that.
In your EOC, is there any permanently installed equipment, or is it really up to the operator that's going to show up to provide support to bring along whatever he has to deploy?
Our EOC does have the equipment. It's actually in a training room in the hospital, so we have to set it up. But we have a box with all the equipment. We have antennas on the roof. We have coax coming down the walls into the room. So we have to set up the radio in the EOC room, but we can do that fairly quickly.
And is that, HF, VHF?
Yeah, we have the 800 DTRS radio. That's the statewide system that the local governments use. We have IC 701, which is, UHF, VHF, HF radio. So we can go on VHF, UHF, mm-hmm. and HF bands.
So I know I've been holding your feet to the fire, and I apologize. That's my job. It makes David uncomfortable when I do that. But let me give you the opportunity to look out not only at your own Aries volunteers, but across the country. Anybody who's watching this Emcomm Extra episode, you can point your finger at the camera, because I hear this all the time from everybody who's involved in the leadership of these activities, is that we need more of you to have a wider toolbox, a broader toolbox, and a digital toolbox. And it's going to be different in each area. Everyone picks which one they're going to favor, but you can't have them all in the mix. You got to have something in common with the next guy you got to send a message to, and you need to know how to use it. I'm going to guess that if you wanted to get strict with your membership, Steve, that you would say, yes, get more digital and do it now.
I think the key part is pick two or three modes that apply best to your situation and practice. It's better to have something you know how to use really well, as opposed to four things that you know about but you haven't done much with.
Yeah.
And I'll echo that. I think our biggest challenge in the Aries organization in Southern California, and actually the other organizations that I've participated with as well, it's finding those, I'll call them Elmers, right, that understand this is how, WinMore works, or this is how FLDigi works, or, fill in the name of the tool you want to use to send the data that you need to send works, and get those people signed up so that they can do the training, right? That's my biggest challenge, right? Yeah. Who knows it, who can share it, and who can support it?
So if we've got somebody out there in the audience that is in a leadership capacity in any organization, state or regional or county, that has successfully implemented getting digital among, let's say, most of your volunteers, send David some email. We want to talk to you.
Yeah. Send me an email. Absolutely. Yeah.
W0DHG Delta Hotel Golf at ARL.net. And, cause we want to find where those success stories are. I'm contending there aren't nearly enough of them. I'm not going to say there aren't any, but not enough. So, now that I've bashed, your end of the state, for not being digital enough, Steve, I'm going to bash something else here. I'm just searching for Colorado Aries stuff. Here's a website, coloradoaries.org. When all else fails, and yeah, a few stories on the homepage. The newest one is over a year old, and there's a couple from a couple more years old. And the July 2014 update, what's going on here? Why is there the Colorado Aries website years out of date? Is that the active website Colorado Aries uses? Or when you look for communication within your state organization, is there someplace else to go? Because that's what came up in my search.
I don't think so. I'm not... Like I said, really, I know a lot of the people on the front range and the EC and the assistant ECs very well, but I don't know much about the webpage.
Okay. You don't use it?
No.
It's not a method of communication for you guys. So how do you communicate? How do you talk to your membership? How do you put stuff out that people can then go consume? Mailing lists? Net,
yeah,
the Thursday night net.
Emails and stuff, yeah. All the above.
Okay, but not a website, apparently.
That's correct. Yes.
Okay, I guess if I'm going to complain about anything, it's there. And if somebody goes searching for Colorado Aries, if I'm a brand new ham and I'm hunting for activity, and trying to learn about what Aries is all about, I'm going to end up there, and it's going to be from 2015, 2016. 2014. So, that ain't good. it's 20, and just in case anyone's calendar stalled, it's June 2017. So
yes, it is. I think we've seen this in our Aries organization as well, and I don't want to make excuses, but some of it has to do with the large income that the people, that the web manager, the webmaster is probably making for doing these updates.
Yeah, there is that, but maybe what they need is somebody like me to stick a needle in their butt and say,
yeah,
update your website or turn it off.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think sometimes too, they go for the too hard. You know, you gotta go find a good WordPress and make it blog, make it as easy as Facebook, so you can get in there and do a post now and then, and yeah, it'll look like it's updated and easy.
I don't know. You guys use Facebook, Steve?
I don't use it, so I'm not aware of other people using it.
Yeah, so, it's that embarrassment of riches. We have too many ways to communicate, and not everybody's on the same channel.
So your Aries group, do you guys do weekly nets?
We have our Aries group is very informal. We have the Amateur Radio Club has a weekly net, and it's, quote, the Aries net as well as the weekly net.
Mm-hmm. About how many check-ins?
Oh, we have about 10, 12 check-ins, okay, probably.
Okay. And you guys share information and traffic and whatever's going on in those. Do you meet? Right. You guys meet on a regular, like, monthly basis or a couple times a year?
Yeah, the Aries meeting is built into the club meeting, and the club meets once a month.
Okay.
And we have a breakfast once a month as well.
So just in case anybody's Colorado geography is not great, here's and for those of you that are watching on video and not doing the audio, I just brought up the map of the state from Google Maps, and you know, Denver is sort of central, a little bit north, but more central. And from Denver, straight north and south is where the mountains begin. Anything to the east, this extremely empty looking territory to the east, is prairie, and anything to the west is mountains. Let me look at the satellite view, it'll be even more dramatic. What part of the state are you in, Steve?
Okay, so see where your arrow is?
Move a little over to the Aspen, left. Yeah.
Move to the left and down a little bit in that nook there, up a little bit.
We're going to add a few more towns here.
Okay, yeah. Well, you can. Your arrow is just to the right of where I live in Hotchkiss.
Okay, so there's Hotchkiss.
Right there. And you can see the Grand Mesa is 11,000-foot flat. Top mountain is between us and Grand Junction, which is the biggest city on the western side of the state.
Switch back to the map, Gary. Sorry. Gives you a little more perspective there. Okay, yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
All right, and so all of this is very small towns, fairly widely scattered, and because it's mountains, not much in between them. Not even something you would call rural, something that you would call empty, or just, you know, pretty mountains.
Well, I'd call it rural because there are people here, but when you get out on the plains where there's, you know, nothing but cattle for miles, that would be really empty.
Yeah.
You know, we have ski resorts, and we have not close where I live, but near in the area. So there's a varied population. It's not as barren as other places.
All right. You had pointed me to a couple of other sites to look at. That you had recently discovered and hadn't even gone into real depth yourself, this the Interoperable Communications Technical Assistance Program, ICTAP, I suppose.
ICTAP.
Okay.
Yeah. I've seen this page.
Cindy is sending me texts. Okay, so you've been there, David.
I've seen this page. I haven't spent a lot of time on it, but I've seen it.
All right, I'm going to slide over to... now I forget which one I wanted. Did I want this one? Yeah, this is the one that I wanted.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let me show people where I went to. The website is public safety. Yeah. Website is publicsafetytools.info, not .com, .info, I-N-F-O. So publicsafetytools.info. And way over on the right, there's this COMU, Communications Unit Overview Training. And within that, there's an Auxcom overview. And within that, there's a bunch of videos. And communications unit, emergency operations center, a 17-minute video. The auxiliary emergency communicator, that's an AEC, but it's a different kind of AEC than the ARIES AEC. The AEC roles and responsibilities. Let's take a look at a little bit of the video from the auxiliary emergency communicator and see what it looks like. It's just a, it's a chalk talk.
That brings us to us, brings us to you, the auxiliary emergency communicator. And again, within this program, anytime you see this AEC, that is, I think we all know from some other programs that there is another term for EC or AEC. A lot of people may know that as assistant emergency coordinator under ARIES or RACES type programs. That is not what that means here. This is okay. Auxiliary emergency communicator. This is any, a broad term for any volunteer radio operator or non-paid operator that's working within your incident. And
So that appears to be a class, classroom situation. Is that the kind of class that you teach?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah, that I think that's several years old, but yeah, that's the course that I teach. I'm one of the instructors.
Okay, so that's one of the things you can find. And yeah, I mean things change fast, and other than Ham Radio Now programs, it's kind of hard to get new stuff on the internet real fast. And that's one of the reasons why I do these interviews and not training programs, because training programs take a long time to produce, and interviews, they're fast.
And they're expired as, or they're out of date as soon as you're done publishing them, right?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Yeah, these aren't really evergreen. Somebody looking here at Ham Radio 330 in the year 2022 is going to say that just doesn't make any sense.
Right.
We got a few evergreen programs out there, not very many. All right. So, but there's these five videos, and it could be interesting. I don't know where they were from. They don't look.
That first one gives you a little bit more. I've watched these. The first one gives you a little bit more of who they are, an introduction, and what have you, in the beginning, those instructors.
Okay. And you can download them
yep.
or watch them online. And it looks like they've got some PowerPoints to go along if you want to. You want to download this too. So once again, that is publicsafetytools.info, and then keep clicking the wait a minute, how did we get here? Yeah. Oops.
It's not from that website. There you go.
There we go.
Under
training, COMU, the communications unit overview training, and then Auxcom overview. There's COMU pre-coursework. Plenty of places to go to learn stuff.
What do you want to point out there, Steve?
If you go back to the website with all the boxes.
Yeah.
A very interesting one is the Auxiliary Field Operations Guide, AuxFog.
Oh, okay.
That's a document you can download. And it has a lot of very well-organized information for amateur radio operators used for auxiliary communications. And my understanding is that they intend to put that into a application, you know, like on your phone as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The other one that.
Yeah, I got lost in it.
Okay.
So let's see.
The other book. There you go.
It's a PDF. There's a PDF you can get from the bottom left. There's a PDF link to it.
Okay. Yeah, I'm lost in all of the possibilities for what this is. And I don't think nothing shows up as AuxFog here.
You go back one click, Gary.
I don't have a go back.
So do the viewing, not the printing one, do the viewing.
Yeah. I tried that too. It took me to the same place.
So on the bottom on the left, there's a little PDF that does not open. Oh no. Viewer download on the bottom right. Because basically this is just a PDF.
Oh, there we go. Yeah.
I've got a copy of this. We use this. I use this as a reference. And there's AuxFog, and I guess there's NiFog is a new.
Right. Yeah, the NiFog is the one that has all the interoperability information. Yeah. Tremendous. Yes.
Yeah. I got a copy of that. Somebody handed me one of those, too.
And those are passed out in the class. The students get one of those.
You guys pass those out. So Steve, yes. did you raise your hand one day at the Aries meeting and say, I want to be the instructor for this? How did they sign you up? How did you find your way to doing the training? And then how did you become an instructor?
Okay. So like I said, the training was basically the communications unit training for the all hazards communications unit leader.
Yep.
And so I'm involved with people that are also COMELs and, in Mars that are all, it's sort of the same small community. So when it came time to get a couple instructors, then we're looking at somebody on the Western Slope. And I said, well, I can do that. And I had the qualifications to do that. I did take the Auxcom class when it was first offered 5, 6, 7 years ago. And then it was a while before it came back to Colorado. It's the most first or second most popular or frequently requested class from OCTAP by the states, but there are a limited number of instructors and not all states have their own instructors. So it takes a while sometimes to get the class. And that's why when they created the unit or working to create the unit here in Colorado, we worked on getting some local instructors so we could have people trained.
What's an OCTAP?
That's the website you're at, Office of Communications or
Let's see.
Technical Assistance Program, Office of Communications Technical Assistance Program. ICTAP. And
that's like a national organization.
Yeah, it's part of Homeland Security. Department of Homeland Security. So what happens is after 9/11 and Katrina, there's a lot of emphasis on interoperability. So, and when they created Department of Homeland Security, they have created these offices, the Office of Emergency Communications, and ICTAP is part of that. And so they offer technical assistance courses. It can be workshops. It might be how to create communications exercises. They have a class on governance and how a state would manage interoperability inside the state. One of the things I expound on here, you've mentioned previous programs, interoperability has several facets. Most people deal just with the technical part. Oh, I have that radio. I can talk to anybody in the world. But it doesn't really work that way. You need to have some structure that's called guidance. You need some training. You need practice and exercises. And so if you have people that can send a message by voice very efficiently, they may get it done by someone who's, I think I can do packet. Let me see how that works. So there's more aspects to interoperability than just having the equipment.
Yeah.
And so those lanes are, if you will, for interoperability are part of what the ICTAP helps states develop, governance, training, exercises, things like that.
One of the people giving a talk a couple years ago that I recorded about interoperability, one of the great points that he made was the worst thing in the world, the last thing you want is everybody being able to talk to everybody on the same channel, because no one will get anything through if everyone's trying to talk to everyone. You need the ability to be able to talk to someone, but not the constant connection.
Right. And yeah. One concept you could have is discipline. If you get on CB or family radio service, there's no discipline or governance. Right. You become an amateur, you can't play music and you can't interfere with people. And then if you get into Aries, you're going to use ITU phonetics and plain language and a little bit more discipline. And you get into Auxcom, or particularly in something like Mars, you have, or public safety communications, they're very brief, very concise, to the point. So the governance or discipline or organization gets stronger as you go up that chain.
So with all of this training, all of the courses, all of the various ways to learn how to do things, if this is what you really want to do, if this is if you're really dedicated to it, you can dig in and spend a lot of time. Is there room for hams that don't want to make that the most important thing in their life but would like to help out?
Yeah, I think so. I think being in Aries, generally, you don't have to spend hours and hours being in Aries. You can do the other ham radio things and still be in Aries. And then if you're more, want to focus, spend more time and effort on certain aspects, and you can get into the Auxcom thing and stuff like that. It's a gradual thing. You know, there are people in amateur radio that get into amateur radio because they go hiking and they want emergency communications. They don't want to be hams, if you will. So, yeah, I'd say just regular involvement in Aries or races, whatever you have at some level is fine.
And it seems like to me in a disaster, when if you guys get activated, and that's what we call it here, the regular Aries guys that haven't been through the Auxcom program, those are the guys you send to the shelter, right, to receive the informations, the requests, some of the sending out the traffic, right, as opposed to the guys you put in the EOC, because they need to be more polished and familiar with the protocols, because they're going to be dealing with the the incident command structure per se, right? Or did I miss it totally?
No, I that's probably valid. The example I would use is that if something bad happens, the people at the EOC will be on the radio. You may have someone who's managing the net that's not at the EOC that manages the net every week, and then the other amateurs are out reporting, well, this road is blocked, this the trees are down here, the power lines are down there. They can provide a lot of situational awareness without having had all that training.
So what's your minimum level of training? What hurdle do you have to cross? Because you don't want people to just show up. So what minimum level do you have to cross to be able to be useful?
Well, in terms of the Auxcom, we've explained it. You have to take the classes, be a ham, and then take the Auxcom course. In terms of Aries, it varies widely. You need an amateur radio license to be an Aries.
Yeah, that's about in our organization, it's that, and you got to have the beating heart thing, and we'd like you to do more than that, but it doesn't always work out that way.
So your first steps besides just showing up would be that the course 100, 200, 700, 800. Which you take online, and each takes a few hours. But it doesn't, and none of them teach you very much about actually operating a radio or getting on a net. My impression, and it's been a long time since I've been through them, my impression was to impress upon me that there is a structure. And I may not remember very much about that structure once I finish the course, but if I start participating, I will see the structure and at least have a passing familiarity with it. And then the courses beyond that, the FEMA courses and the ARL courses that we talked about in the previous show, teach you actually what you're going to be doing with your radios, make you more useful.
Right. Yeah. It's part of being part of the organization more than the technical aspects, but you're right. It's sort of like the amateur radio license is a license to learn. Well, those first FEMA courses give you an idea, and then the more you are involved, then you get to see how things happen. And that's a big part of what the Auxcom course is getting you very familiar with what is outlined in those basic courses.
But it sounded like from what you talked about, the way the course is laid out, it's a lot of tabletop kind of role-playing exercises, right? So you learn by doing as opposed to you learn by having somebody lecture to you, and you know, if this happens, you need to do this. If this happens, you need to do that. It sounds like more like you're giving them a scenario, and people have to kind of use the brain to figure out, oh, I could do this, I could do that, and I'll assume that there's some kind of feedback loop at the end of that, right, as you go along.
Right. As I mentioned, the main part is having the members in the class know how to write a communications plan based on the scenario and the instructions they're given by the incident commander, the COMEL, or the emergency manager on what they're specifically supposed to provide for that incident or situation.
What their needs are.
Right. So yeah. You could look at the organization chart and figure out, well, this channel will do this or that, but the emergency manager says, I need this, I need that. And, you know, we have to have a link here that doesn't normally exist. So you have to provide the plan with the frequencies and tones and all that stuff to accommodate that situation, and then assign people that you have to man those positions.
And you would really like people to learn all that stuff before the actual incident or simulated the test.
Right. So, like I said, there's, I think it's 6 or 7 times that you go through this. You're in a group. Each group of 4 or 5 people has to come up with a plan, and then they have to present it to the others. But by the time they get, the first one is like, it takes a long time. And the last one is the most complicated, and they do it very quickly because they've had a lot of practice doing that. And again, what it shows is somebody says, I need you to do this, and a few minutes later or whatever, they say, here's our plan. We can do it for you.
Yeah, excellent.
Sounds good to me.
So there were 2 things that we talked about at the beginning of the show that we would say we would get to before we were done. And let's take a look at them. Still looking at Tropical Storm Cindy. And, you know, still bearing down on the Texas coast, but it's not looking real big. All this stuff over here is not really part of it. It's just, you know, this tiny little churning there. So they're going to get some flooding and stuff, but no call out for amateur radio, still nothing from the Hurricane Watch Net, nothing on the ARL website, but
go back to the track for 1 sec here. Yeah. And go ahead. Go on to your question.
Oh, I was going to say, but if it were something, if it were a major hurricane that was starting to move in, this is field day weekend.
Yeah.
And the bands are going to be full, and most of the people are not going to be in those areas, but they are going to occupy every available frequency on every HF band that is open to any place. What do we do when there's a real serious emergency and it's a big contest or field day? Field day is the most occupancy that we have, but there's some other big contests that pretty much fill up bands.
Field day is not a contest.
Sure it is. Do we keep score? Are there winners?
Yeah, okay, all right. Well, I never got a certificate for my score, although we never scored that well.
Yeah.
Sorry. Jump in there, Steve.
Yeah, all right. I've been on both sides of that issue. Our club is very active at field day, and we know how to get all the points we can, supposedly.
So, what happens? I mean, have you ever been in a situation where you guys have an active fire or a flood in the western part of the state? You need to be able to talk to the EOC in the eastern part of the state. You got to do it on HF.
Well, one of the things that we practice on and works best for us is the 60 meter band.
No field day on 60. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. And it, so far it's getting more popular, but it, as far as I know, but it's really great for MCOM. One is the right frequency for NVIS for the state. So most of the time it will work from somewhere in the state to the EOC. And then it's not the contest band and things like that. Yeah. So it's more available.
60.
Go ahead.
60 meters was authorized to hams in the, I think, early 90s. And a few years on, I was asking our local areas group, we can do anything on 60? Our statewide areas group, rather. And are you doing anything on 60? No, you know, not enough people have 60 meters. 10 years on. Nah, not enough people have 60 meters. 20 years on. Nah, not enough people have 60 meters. It was over 20 years we've had that band. Why do most states not have 60 meters incorporated in their statewide areas activity? That's why we got it. Just exactly what you said, Steve. That's because it is the perfect band for daytime NVIS operation. And Why isn't everybody using it?
Inertia.
Because my radio doesn't have 60 meters. Your radio has got to be 30 years old to not have 60 meters. Yeah.
Hey, Gary, my radio doesn't do 60 meters.
I believe I'm talking to you. Wait a minute. Got to push the right button here. I believe I'm talking to you, David.
You're talking to me. Yeah, the radio over here in my Go Box, it doesn't do 60 meters. And neither does the one on my counter here. And yeah, they're older radios. And yep.
Right. And when will you get DTMF and your 2-meter radio?
Yeah, and subaudible tone, PL.
Well, you know, it's so interesting. I know occasionally when I follow, hey, there's a disaster going on here or a disaster going on there, you'll see sometimes posted out on the ARL side or some of the other online forums saying, hey, you know, we're working traffic with this, you know, remote location on HF and leave these frequencies clear. Or I'll make an assumption that if, you know, on, you know, Saturday morning, there's a huge, you know, earthquake in South America somewhere, they're going to do the same thing and say, hey, we're passing traffic back and forth and from Ecuador or whatever, and please keep, you know, 7. Whatever free to support that issue.
Yeah, but who's seen that?
Yeah, I don't know.
And you know, what'll happen is there'll be some activity. Some ham will come on there. Testing 1, 2. Is anybody using this frequency? Yeah. Get off the frequency. It's in use for emergency communication. Your kill cycle cop will show up. And sometimes I guess it can be effective. Mostly we just kind of hope that, in my experience, we just kind of hope that people will stay away. And sometimes you can sort of convince someone that, yeah, you're using the frequency. I guess that's why we use 2 meters and maybe 60.
Maybe.
So, David, you got to upgrade your radio or I'm going to get ranting at you again.
Yeah, I'm going to get there.
Steve, your radio does 60?
Of course.
Your HF.
Which radio is it? I'm looking for advice.
All of them.
Well,
okay, so looking back behind me, there the 756 Pro 3, I had to pull a diode. The 706 sitting on the second shelf, I had to pull a diode. Even my Icom 7000, which is, well, now an obsolete radio, but for a while it was, you know, current radio. Even a radio that recent, Icom, incorporated some 60 meters, but when they moved the middle channel, had to pull a diode and make it operate on all the available frequencies. You got to sometimes do some of that. Are yours even so old that you can't even pull the diode and make them work?
I'm searching right now.
What are your radios?
So the one in my Go Box is it's an Elenco DX70. And then I think I can pull a diode according to this.
Yeah. My father-in-law has a Kenwood TS430.
Yeah, that's what I have. I have that one too.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, you
430S.
Can. You can, like, set that up. And what he had it done for him, but somebody set it up so that using 5 of the memory positions covered the 5 channels. But you can dial them in.
Yeah,
memories are handy because the frequencies are kind of, no one speaks of them as frequencies. We refer to them as channels 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Do you guys call them frequencies, Steve, or just 60 meters channel 2?
Probably both. You know, since they belong to the NTIA, they're channelized, so they're channels.
Yeah, I don't remember I know they're in 5 megahertz, around 5.5 megahertz someplace. I know that. I
use 5.3.
I couldn't dial one in if my life depended on it. I use memories to find them, and I push the lock button so I don't slip off. So there's that. Okay. So the other thing was this thing which appeared, it's beginning of the month, so it's not that old. On the ARL website, the build out of the nationwide first responders broadband network could drive ARRI's changes. It's the First Responder Network Authority, something called FirstNet, a nationwide wireless broadband network for first responders, and it could change the complexion of how the amateur radio emergency service functions to support communications for responders during disasters and emergencies. This is, it's up on the ARL website. You have to go back a little bit because June 1st is when it came up. There's a bunch more detail, but there's not enough detail to really tell us what it's all about because it's really something that they're just getting started with. But AT&T, I guess, has been chosen as the company that's going to build it out. But what they're building out, I have no idea. Is it cell phones? Is it just a wireless broadband network? That, you know, what will it start as and what will it end up being? And what will those changes be for amateur radio? We are not going to answer that question in the next 5 minutes. But what have you guys heard about this? Has it made an impression on you at all yet?
In Colorado, it's a big deal because the geography of the state is a challenge. If you have, there's places that don't have good cell phone coverage.
Yeah, those mountains.
When the state put in several years ago their DTRS system, the coverage wasn't as good as they thought. So the public safety agencies say, yeah, if you're going to provide something, you have to provide what you say you are. And so there are challenges with the coverage. Each state has the option of providing their own system that would tie into the FirstNet and not just using the AT&T system. Colorado is very actively, closely looking at and getting proposals on how would they do their own system. They've looked at the coverage maps and had concerns about that. And so it will vary, could vary greatly from state to state. And just to editorialize, some of the things we've mentioned already still won't be covered. And I think they're in the column in the QST, and that is situational awareness is provided by amateur radio operators. All the public safety agencies are busy. There's a lot of concern, particularly in our area, about when the lights go out for whatever reason, how are you going to communicate? That system will be challenged by that as well. Cell phones go down, that's going to go down, et cetera. Things there'll be some priority, I guess, but you know, cell phone systems get overloaded when something bad happens, and they're internet dependent to a great extent. So way back when you had telegraph and radio, now 100 years later, things are catching up and the radio aspect is not as critical, but in the right situation, it could be critical. You know, there's one of the acronyms is PACE, P-A-C-E, primary, alternate, contingency, and emergency. So if you have four levels of communication, amateur radio may be in contingency or emergency, but those are the things you need to practice most often, because if you have a grid and you say least situations that are least costly and situations that occur frequently or infrequently, the ones you worry about the most are the ones that have a high risk and low frequency. And that would be where emergency communications need the most practice, because every day everybody uses a cell phone. If they don't have a cell phone, they can probably figure out how to use that fax machine. But the amateur radio aspect is least used, and in the worst situation, it would need to be used. So you practice and train on it more.
Hey, Steve, so you said you guys have a relationship with fire department, right? With your organization, when you train with that organization, is it just hams, or are you working with the first responders as well?
I'm involved. I'm on the fire department, so that's the association. Our fire department is the alternate EOC for the county, so we have an HF radio station there as well. Mm-hmm. But I have been working in the wildland fire community in the past as a radio operator, NWCG. Our fire department sends people out to wildfires where they're either as a part of a crew or individual assets that go to wildfires. I haven't done that in a while, but I have done that in the past.
Mm-hmm. But you would be seen more as a first responder in that circumstance, as opposed to amateur radio operator that's being deployed to the You'd be part of the fire organization in that.
Yes, sense, right? Yeah, I'm an active member of the fire department.
Got it. Okay.
I guess I should have asked you a long time ago what your background is besides being a ham that led you into doing all this. So has fire department been your occupation for a long time, or is that?
Yeah, I was a full-time firefighter in Arizona for 20 years, retired, moved to Colorado, got on the fire department here about the same time I was a ham, and just as I left Arizona after I'd retired there, got more involved here. When I got on the fire department here, there were wildland fires, and I went to the classes, and they have radios, so I got involved in that, and then took the Auxcom and the Comel classes and got involved with helping the regional emergency planning team. We have all hazards planning areas in Colorado, and so the six counties have the emergency managers get together, and I got involved with helping them with radio stuff.
Have you noticed more and more of your fellow emergency management employees or first responders who had not been in ham radio, didn't come in through ham radio, but are getting ham licenses and getting involved?
In our area, yes, one of the emergency managers has a ham license, and the others are very supportive of having hams and their EOCs provide backup communications.
All right. David, I think I'm out of gas here. You got anything you want to add?
No, I think that's good. And I think you're better off not hearing from me what I thought about the whole FirstNet thing. I'm not retiring my equipment anytime soon. Let's put it that way.
Well, that's what this article was, the ARL website was trying to lead hams into, because you're going to hear about it. And it's, it's like, we're still going to have something to do. So,
yeah.
And as Steve was just saying, that thing may diminish, it'll never go away, and that's why we got to keep training. And when one of the arguments, back in the days, or I guess we're still sort of talking about the bills that have been, we're still waiting for a bill to get through Congress for antenna relief with homeowners associations, and the people who don't understand ham radio would say, well, just use your ham radio when there's an emergency. You can put up an antenna then.
Oh, yeah.
And they don't understand the concept that if we can't use it all the time, a number of things are a consequence of that. First of all, we won't have it. We won't care. We won't be participating. And then second, we won't know how. We need constant use of our amateur radio equipment and training to be able to be ready for when that happens. And that's how ham radio can be that least frequent but most important link at the tail end when everything else has fallen apart, when all else fails.
You got to drag it out and play with it.
Yeah, because we use it all the time, and we have it all the time. And then when the chips are down, it's there, and we know how to use it in theory. Need more digital.
Yeah.
He said, looking at the shack behind him, which has got no digital capability. I do the television show. I'm not your comm leader.
Yeah.
But David, you are.
Well, I think
you
I
are.
Think
so, that wraps so David, 60 meters.
Yeah, I'm working on the 60 meters. I we were looking through that. I downloaded the mod for that one radio. It means I got to take it out of the Go box. So we'll see.
Probably needs a good dusting anyway.
No, that one actually gets used quite a bit. Pull that one out now and then.
Steve, thank you for joining us. We've had fun, I think.
Yeah.
And maybe even taught somebody
something.
Thank you very much. All right.
My pleasure. Thank you.
I'm going to put you on the side here for a second. Oops. That side. Go back to the side by side. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. You got your Arvin is there. You're slicing him in half. Our two Arvins are side by side now. HamRadioNow.tv if you enjoy the programs. And field day this weekend, what are you doing?
Sigh.
You just got back from like a 2-week vacation in Italy?
Yeah. RD, our DEC has a secret mission this weekend, and we'll be going elsewhere to perform a large scale test. And I can't really say much more than that. And so our field day plans have kind of shriveled. I'm going to probably put on my ARL pin and go drive around and see a couple other sites. And I may work one Bravo from my driveway.
Okay. I am going to be accompanying our North Carolina section manager, Carl, W4CHX, good friend of mine. North Carolina is a real wide state. It's, you know, 400 miles wide or something. I think the western edge of North Carolina is in Los Angeles County. I'm not sure, but I think it kind of is. Crosses just south of Colorado. And we are is sort of to the east. We're, you know, east of the middle of the state. But he has to cover the whole state. So he's going to head west, and I'm going to go with him, and we're going to go visit, like you're talking about, visit field day sites. And I'll tote the camera along. And we'll be operating, we'll take my car, we'll be operating mobile, W4CHX1Charlie, probably on 40 meters, 20 meters, 15 if it's open, you know, whatever's open. It's surprising what you can do from a mobile on field day, because people want to talk to you. They want yeah. that contact. So even though we don't have the biggest signal on the band, we're heard pretty well, and we'll have a lot of fun.
How about you, Steve?
Yeah, what are you doing for field day?
Our club is very active. It'll be the 20th year I've been involved. We have a big field day going on, 2A. So I'll be there.
What's the call sign you'll be using?
Yeah, what's
K0IIT.
Okay.
He's got a club call sign.
Make sure you write that down in front of you so you give that and not your own.
Yeah, there you go. Been there, done that.
Yeah, there's a big sign. So, a big sign. Yeah.
You'll be a 2A?
Yes. Yeah. And we have at Montrose, Colorado.
All right.
Montrose Amateur Radio.
Typically one CW and one phone, or is everybody phone or digital?
No, we have the CW operators get preference. We have two stations, so they operate as much as they can, and then we fill in with phone around them.
Okay, so CW centric.
That's how ours. We're usually two alpha as well, and usually if there's a CW operator on the grounds, they're working CW, and us voice guys will squeeze in between when they need a break or a sandwich or something else.
Yeah, my club always does, but the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society always does a big station. So it's somewhere between 6, 7, 8, 9A. So there's plenty of room for everybody with a separate station on every band. And maybe two, sometimes three operating CW, but a lot of phone operation. So only got a few hardcore CW operators in that group. All right, you guys, thank you very much. That is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Steve Schroeder, K10KY is what I got written down here, right, David?
K10KY.
An AEC for A County in Western Colorado. Just a county? Your authority extends?
Our regions are matched up with the Homeland Security regions, so it's Region 8.
Okay, so your authority extends more broadly.
Right, the six counties for the all hazards region.
In the pretty part of Colorado.
Yes.
And it gets you in trouble, folks on the other side. By the way, I will be coming out to Colorado in a few weeks, just as a place to land the plane. And a place to stay, but we'll go up to Wyoming during the eclipse. You got plans to head north and see the eclipse?
No, I don't.
He's right out there where it's going to be perfect. The eclipse will cross South Carolina at 4-hour drive from where I am now, but the chances of the weather being good are very small. So. A bunch of friends and I we're flying out to Denver, and we'll drive up to as rural a place as we can find. Every place is going to be crowded with people, I think, anywhere near the point of totality, but a little bit east of Casper someplace. And because the chances of a clear sky are the best in that part of the country, as you know. But
Yes.
It could very well be that we end up totally socked in. And the folks, my wife is going to take her dad down to Columbia, South Carolina, which is right under the totality line. It could be great there. We'll see. It takes your chances. And we're going to tourist around a little bit more. We're not going to get as far west as you are. But we'll tourist a little bit up and down the Front Range before that. And probably not playing very much ham radio, but I'll bring some handy talkies and stuff, and we'll talk to the local guys on the repeaters.
Oh, I thought they were going to do some kind of contest during that.
Don't know about a contest. I'll
look at that for next time.
Yeah. At Dayton, I was talking to the CSI the Ham Citizen Science Investigations guy. They're going to try to get signal reports to see what effect the eclipse has on propagation. And they think it will have some effect. Now, the eclipse is not going to take the sun away from the ionosphere very much, you know, 20, 30 miles wide, and that's about it. So I'm not sure how much effect that it's going to have, but they think it's going to have some. So we'll see. But I'm going to stand there where the sun goes away and the animals all start freaking out, pretending it's night.
Get your safety glasses now.
Yeah, my friend Jeff, AC4ZO, has got all those things. But I understand that during the period of totality, you can look directly at where the sun was behind the moon, and that's safe. So I'm always careful, especially during a lunar eclipse when the moon is obscured, not to stare directly at the moon, because dangerous.
Yeah.
No one's paying attention to what I'm saying. It's nonsense. Okay.
Alrighty, then.
I think we're done. We did the Arvin pitch. It's just time to say goodbye. I don't know, Steve, have you ever made it to the end of a Ham Radio Now show?
I think so, once.
You're the one.
I mean, no. No. I don't know the ending.
Yeah,
that's what you're asking.
Well,
I bet you get it.
Yeah, we'll give you the last word.
You get the last word.
Yeah. So I say, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. David?
I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Steve?
Steve Schroeder, KI0KY.
Over.
And?
Out.
And you know how that's bad radio procedure, right?
It is.
Do you guys cover that in your course? Tell them never to say
no,
that?
No, it's not in there, but I'm in Mars, so I know that.
Yeah. I've been watching movies, broadcast television, you know, the Hollywood stuff, and I'm hearing that more and more. Maybe it's just because the phrase stands out to me, but I hear that all the time now in everything from NCIS and everybody uses radio. It's over and out. So that's what people told me. It's a Hollywood thing. Clearly is. See you guys. Bye-bye.
7-3.
Thanks. Okay.